Welcome to this AbundantChange.com program, brought to you by Music Outreach Publishing. We here at Music Outreach hope you will enjoy and be uplifted by this offering, and wish you many blessings. And now, without further ado, here is author and founder of Music Outreach Publishing, Michael Purvis. Hello, everyone. I'm Michael Purvis, the author of this program and founder of AbundantChange.com and Music Outreach Publishing. The AbundantChange.com recording you're about to experience is my attempt to delight, uplift, and instruct people of all ages through music and the spoken and written word throughout the United States and all over the world. As an author, inspirational performer, artist, and teacher, I have made it my goal to create inspiring books, recordings, and videos which will touch the lives of and benefit children, youths, young adults, adults, couples, and senior citizens. So, through the magic of technology, here I am, ready to uplift you with words and music on all sorts of beneficial, uplifting, spiritual, and growth-inducing topics. If you or someone you know would like more information about AbundantChange.com materials available worldwide from Music Outreach Publishing, stay with us at the end of this recording, and we'll give you information about how to contact us. And now, without further ado, on with our program. Let's begin with our Abundant Change theme song. Words speak to all ages, God's gift to me and you. You can put them down to music, or read and write them too. Abundant change, that's how we humans increase our range of spirit, love, and life anew. May this book be my special gift to you. Old or young, tall or short, we all have tales to tell. We've dreams to dream and things to learn, so we can grow so well. Abundant change, that's how we humans increase our range of spirit, love, and life anew. May this book be my special gift to you. Growing, changing, that's the life we lead. In our hearts and minds and spirits, we have all we need. So now, as we begin our tale, may I be so bold as to hope that it will lift you up, help your new worlds to unfold. Abundant change, that's how we humans increase our range of spirit, love, and life anew. May this book be my special gift to you. Blessings to you from Abundant Change. Harp and Quill. poems, and music for life's journey. Original poems with musical interludes in 5 volumes by Michael D. Purvis. Volume 5, Early Poems, written in the author's 20s. All poems and all music in this recording is copyright Michael D. Purvis. Well, these are indeed all poems written when I was in my 20s. They are part of the early life of myself as a poet. And I thought we would start with some original introductory music, which will capture that feeling of youth. Tender grass. Tender grass, tonight you are a comfort, cool after the heat of the day. You have a transformative power. Your languid fingers massage my weary body, performing quiet alchemy upon my perception this still evening. All is silent, yet soon I hear your whisperings, tender grass. A faint beckoning in the language of vegetation. I cannot understand you at first, but soon the barriers of understanding are transcended, for you speak a language heard within the heart, a language felt upon the skin, carried by the wind, and understood at the precise point where dew-touched blades caress the twilight sky, the point at which I lie. O grass, the stars are your interpreters tonight. I stare up at their twinkling, and soon I can understand your whispers, which seem to say, tonight you lie upon the earth, with only the grass between you and that from whence you came. You and the earth are one, child. Reclaim your creation. Be reborn and claim yourself. It is your inheritance. O grass, you are far wiser than I had supposed. I have heard you before as the voice of my dreams. I know you are wise, and would speak only the truth to me. But how can I reclaim a creation which has never been mine? I wait for a reply, but the grass does not answer. Now I go in search of the Father, who is Father and yet is me, for I am a part of him, and I shall return to him, not just to be with him, but to assimilate into him. Where is the line between creator and creation? Is there a line at all? If there is a line, I think it is porous, and father and child travel back and forth, weaving over and through it to make a garment of great beauty. until that line is hidden, or perhaps fades away, until there is only father-son, sheltered beneath the blanket of love. Free Grace. My God, when will you hold me in your gentle protecting hand and carry me safely in your pocket as you move over the land? When will you restore my fearful soul in the tepid pool of my spirit and set me adrift, my soul a flower open to you, floating like a water lily? When will you soothe my aching heart in the warm balm of your voice and rock me in your holy cradle, rock me with the ebb and flow of your breath? And when, O my God, will my eyes finally see, through the smoky veil of suffering, your radiant being, transforming me utterly when I see your indescribable face? I cannot conceal my impatience, nor mask my suffering, nor am I anywhere near grateful enough to merit what grace has been mine. But it is human to yearn for transcendence, and so I yearn and strive to believe that grace is really free. Sunday, summer evening. A Sunday summer evening with this certain summer evening smell coming through the window. Soft lamplight, the gentle patter of rain and distant rushing cars. You are composing melodies downstairs, have done so all evening. Their charms float up to my half-listening ear. I am working too, but am so needy, like thirsty ground. Yet I cannot disturb you. It is so hard for you to work with distraction. Finally, you call from downstairs. Your music has stopped. The sound of the rain remains. You call and step wearily up the stairs, your treading feet the rhythm of a song I know so well. And then your arms are around me, a blanket of lush harmony. The way I dissolve into you totally, blurring the lines between you and me, is the most exquisite and excellent melody I have ever known, completing the song which is ours alone. I am sure that I dreamed this evening when I was a boy, and understood more perhaps than a boy should. I sensed even then, I think, that you would never please me, and that you would not give me all I needed, that I would be angry with you often and disappointed. But nothing, my love, shall ever compare to the smell of this evening and sound of this rain, and the touch of your lovely fingers running through my hair. Mother Song. Mother sings, oh, she sings love and forgiveness, quietly grieving each disappointment, silently mourning each transgression in her children, She does not sing of mortality or morality, but affirms the good that is present. Lovingly she becomes a mirror, tenderly she reflects the ecstasy in the mild and gentle arts of patience, love, and sacrifice. And she will not despair. She will always insist with the love of Christ in her eyes that people can change and grow, that her children will always be her children. For her there is always hope that children will come to the light. She loves the many-colored light. She gives testimony with her love that the light has many colors, and this is why she changes like a chameleon, capable of loving even the selfish. She will become whatever color she must in order to love them, and it does not compromise her to do so, because she believes that underneath everyone is the color of love. And so she sings, oh, she sings many colors. I did not think one could sing colors, but I know now that colors can be sung, that love can be savored and tasted, that hope and faith are the multicolored songs of mothers, chameleon-hued mothers, seeking not to be consoled, but to console. To Mark Twain. For you will remain a thought, the only existent thought, and by your nature inextinguishable, indestructible. But I, your poor servant, have revealed you to yourself and set you free. Dream other dreams and better. Mark Twain, The Mysterious Stranger. Section 1. Good day, Mr. Clemens, steamboat captain to the world. I am visiting your birthplace today, white clapboard shining, steam whistle shrieking. I am only a small boy, souvenir in hand, yet I sense your gleam in my father's eyes. He is a teacher of English to children in a small town much like this. He loves you so, and so I love you too today. Good day, Mr. Clemens. Section 2. Miss Jean is dead, you cried. The latest blow in a long succession of tragedy. Miss Jean is dead. Now you are a soldier shot through the chest. You loved them all, saw them fall one by one as you struggled to hold a net that vanished in the air. Miss Jean is dead. God has crushed the clay. See it lay amorphous now, lifeless, cold. Surely, then, you were revealed unto yourself. Surely. This was the time to dream other dreams. Did you dream other dreams? Number 3. Aged and ill, wrapped in blankets, Godhead hovering, perhaps you thought, time to sculpt with clay now, Mark, and dream another dream now, Samuel. What did you dream when you wearily requested water and your spectacles, your last earthly request? What did you dream, Mr. Clemens? I think perhaps you dreamed of a young boy crossing the hot bricks of Hannibal, a boy like any other, familiar and yet a stranger, souvenir in hand, a boy and his father, walking the warm bricks of Hannibal, steamboat whistle screaming, river sparkling, clapboard shining. A father and a son, strangers and beloved, heart lights shining, and dreaming other dreams. Rural Madonna. I spent a weekend in rural America, where I touched the essence of my very Catholic family. I visited my grandma, sitting like a serene Madonna in her small house built by her carpenter husband. She sits quietly receiving the offerings of her children and grandchildren, who visit leaving flowers and trinkets, little gifts for mother. She is, to us, a Madonna, the lady of the house, serenely sitting, deserving of gifts from her children, deserving of reverence and devotion. The Waiting. Restore our fortunes, Lord, for we are dead, without your Spirit pouring on us like water, moving in us like a stream. Restore our fortunes, Lord. Inside we live like desert hermits, and outside we are harried, full of worry, uncertainty. Restore our fortunes, Lord. For we are lonely for your touch, and inside thirsty for your Spirit, in need of healing and hope. Restore us, Lord. Once you made us, reached inside your breast, pulled out a piece of yourself, breathed on it, gave it life. Make us new, Lord, with your touch, your breath. Give us your peace. Hold us in the palm of your hand. And give us life. To Eliza Easterday. In memory of Eliza R. Easterday, wife of L. R. Easterday, daughter of Thomas and Paulina Gentry, died November 30th, 1858. Aged 19 years and 9 months and 5 days. She always made home happy, lived beloved, and died lamented. Inscription from an Indiana tombstone, which resides in a small country graveyard, now with a roaring highway very near it. Oh, Eliza Easterday, did you dream when you were so cruelly wrenched from life? When in the agony of birth you left your husband and the babe you would never see, that I would come to know you? Did you dream when you were laying with your babe in this churchyard, when unprepared for death you left them to wed the silent dead, that I would come to love you? Did you dream as you watched this tree above you turn to flame each autumn, and then to bare and back again to green, as you witnessed the passing of season after season, thinking the wind to be your only companion save that of the dead, that I would come to love you? Did you dream as you perceived that your only comfort in death was the blanket of leaves and snow upon your grave, that I would someday stop my automobile, drawn by your untold story, glad to spend an hour peering curiously, straining to read the barely still visible record of your death, and of those you knew, and of those you loved? I think of you each day, Eliza, giving you rebirth in my thoughts, new life each time I pass you at 70 miles an hour. I ride within my machine as you sit upon your wagon, I ride with the radio as your bow is whistling sweetly. I ride sleeping against my love as you dream pressed to your husband. I ride eager for bed as you long for hearth and home. Do you rest in peace now, Eliza? Your grave now a peculiar highway shrine. Do others visit you, disturbing your rest, giving you life in their minds as they roar past? I am not sure, but I think not. I think no others stop and are drawn to you. I think you spoke especially to me, spoke as a tender lover. I think God has given you to me, you and your words, tender, mute speech, a subtle gift that lives in the space of silence. You have given so much to me with your resting and your silent speech which I can hear, your silent words which somehow resound, your silent lullaby which rests yet sings. What can I give you in return for this miracle, this subtle gifting? I cannot bring back the little white church where you were christened, where you were a lovely bride. Long ago it was covered with this road. I cannot bring back your John nor your babe. I do not know that you would want me to. Yet I must give you something, a sweet gift. What shall I give you in return for these lovely orange tiger lilies growing round your grave, a brilliant flash of orange as I race by? What in return for your rain-worn tombstone, this little piece of 1860? What can the living give to the dead? What can pass between us? This poem, I think, the essence of these words, is all that can be given. It travels through the ether and mixes with the rain and the dew. It falls upon your stone and on your tree. You once lived by the grace of a tree. You moved in its charity, sat in its shade, and built your home with the sacrifice of its body. You took from it your last breath and lay inside it when you died. It is under a tree now that you rest. When I stop to visit, I can touch your tree. I can feel its rough old bark, and from it take my breath. I touch its branch and take your arm in mine. I touch a leaf and thus your spirit. This grass becomes your hair, these flowers the remnant of your passion, their scent the ghost of your dreams. This world is etheric. We cannot leave it without leaving in turn the subtle imprint of our passing. We leave our mark upon the air, upon the rain, the stone, and the earth. I think perhaps this is all, really, in the end. And so, sweet Eliza, I give you the gift of this poem. I read it to the trees, to the grass and to the air, grateful to have loved you, grateful to think of you tenderly each day as I pass by in my automobile, grateful to feel the power of love throughout the ages. Your quiet churchyard is surrounded by shrieking motors now. These lilies round your grave, just a flash of orange to me. But the subtle force of eternity is infinitely more powerful than a mad rush of my life. Somehow you whispered this to me, despite the scream of this highway. Somehow you reached me with your silence. You crossed the veil of time to whisper the beautiful language of transience, the lovely and sad song of the ephemeral. You lifted the veil of time to whisper your subtle language, to offer your gift of silence and rest. For me you parted the veil with the breath of your quiet gifting. In return, I offer you my verse. It drifts across the cosmos until it finally comes to rest in your cool and waiting hand. Song of the Seeker. The seeker sat on the porch one night. The moon was shining, lovely and silken and silver. It shone on his face, and the tree across the yard was singing in the wind, each leaf a prayer, an exquisite song to God. And the seeker watched, rapt with the song, rocking in his chair to the rhythm of the wind, to the movement of the melody, this tree and this wind and this light, a symphony he had never stopped to hear before, this tree and this grass and this field, spread before him like a feast. He sat and listened, and it was as if there were highways in his body, roads that he had not been aware of, paths within him he had not known could be trod, and suddenly they were clear. They had been overgrown with briar and brush, and now they were suddenly and effortlessly clear and broad. Open roads, suitable now for walking upon, with the hearty stride of a poet, byways to be traveled, requiring only sturdy shoes and a walking stick. These roads were within him, but he had not noticed. He should have heard them calling before, being by nature a seeker, but he wasn't accustomed to listening to their song. It was on this night, for the first time, that he opened his ears to the song of the open road, to the song of the field and sky, the wind and the leaf. He felt curiously empty and full at once. And then a strange thing happened. A tiny, smallish, soft, and unobtrusive thing happened, so subtle that he might not have noticed. But he did. He saw out of the corner of his eye a tiny bird. It hopped upon the porch where he could see it in the moonlight. It was a sparrow. He was sure of it somehow, though he had no knowledge of birds. In fact, he hardly ever noticed birds before. He rarely took notice of their singing or their small forms. Yet, suddenly, there was this miraculous little creature. He stared at its outline, made clear in the light of the luminous moon. He could see its tiny black eyes shining. And then that little sparrow began to sing. It was not morning nor afternoon, but night. Yet that little creature began to sing to him. It was something of a miracle, yet at the time it seemed the most natural thing in the world. This is the song that the tender creature sang. Corn is singing from her leaves. She sings to the earth with turned-down sheaves. For from her leaves, she sings of the sheaves. For soon comes the farmer to take what he cleaves. Having finished its song, that little bird sat for a moment, as if to listen to the contrasting quiet, to the absence of its song. It sat and ruffled its feathers and cocked its head, and then, as if it might be preparing for sleep, narrowed and closed its eyes and sat motionless until the wind picked up again. Along with the wind came the song of the vegetation, and with the recurrence of the song, the little creature was gone. The seeker rocked slowly to the rhythm of the song and thought to himself, "Tree is singing. Wind and flower and leaf sing too, and now a tiny bird has sung, and I have heard where I never listened before." The grass soon whispered again. Now that you know the earth to be your own creation, you must meet your melancholy lover, the rain. Long ago you embraced and became one, dancing with her until earth and rain became bride and bridegroom. Lover and beloved, you made a home for your children, the grass, the trees, and the flowers. Peacemakers between you and the sky, your children have great beauty and are wise. They stretch and explode with their wisdom into the firmament. "How glorious it is to be your child," whispered the grass. And now he heard the trees and flowers whisper, "Father." Astonished, he implored them, "But I did not create you. God made the earth and all that lives upon it, including myself." The earth, the grass, the trees and flowers were silent. They did not answer for a moment. Presently, he heard them begin to sing. They sang a song with only one word: "Father." The song was beautiful, melodious. Awestruck, he no longer looked up at the stars to question heaven, but looked inside himself, into the interior twilight sky, the inner firmament. He took up the road to find it there. He tread the inward sacred way, singing the song of his children, the grass, the trees, and the flowers, who taught him the song with only one word, Father. And then he rocked, rocked, rocked in his chair to the song that he heard all about him, to this beauty that was all around him, that he saw with new eyes and heard with new ears. He rocked, rocked to the rhythm of life, the rhythm of death. They were one in the song he heard. Birth to death, rock, rock. Death then to birth, rock, rock. Creature to creature, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, and from dust sprang forth new life in endless rocking. The earth, he knew, was God's cradle. Endlessly rocking in God's breath, the wind, endlessly rocking to the song of things growing. All was song and motion and life. All this he heard in the song of a frail little bird singing to the moon. All this he heard. Epiphany. Most gracious Lord of silence, Lord of the abyss and the tiny inward voice, I pray you would grant me peace and patience, and send to me faith and the inspiration to console. But most of all, Lord, I ask humbly for epiphany, for the insight to see the myriad flashes of your divine love in everything I see and everyone I meet. I ask to see you shine forth in the innocent smiles of children, in the love which emanates from saints and sinners, and in the moonlit dew of the grass. I know I will recognize you in everything, if I will only look with the new eyes you give as a free gift with the dawning of each new day. I ask not to see any inequity in the grace of your reign, which falls upon the just and the unjust alike, but instead to become a pool which collects it, offering it to all who would drink, for it is free to all, to saint and to sinner, if we will only drink.
Thank you.
AbundantChange.com program you have been listening to or viewing was made right here in the Music Outreach Publishing Studio in an effort to reach people of all ages across the United States and throughout the world with delightful, uplifting, instructive materials. In addition to this recording, Music Outreach Publishing offers many other AbundantChange.com books, CDs, cassettes, and videos, which appeal to a wide audience, including children, youths, young adults, couples, and senior citizens. If you would like a recording of this program, or to order any other AbundantChange.com materials, you may contact us any of the following ways. You may call our order line at 317-577-8842, extension 2. You may fax us your questions, comments, or orders at 317-585-0748. You may contact us by email at musicbymichael@aol.com. Please visit our sister websites, music-outreach.com and playsinganddream.com. You may contact author Michael Purvis via the contact page on any of our websites. And now, we wish you peace and many blessings.